praise, honor, and glory. Amen. The Lord reigns.
The Lord reigns.
The Lord reigns.
The Lord reigns.
Blessed be the name of the Lord. Amen. Give him a great hand of praise. If you have your Bible, I'm in Psalm 67 today. Psalm 67 will be our text today. Great job, choir and orchestra, leading us into the presence of the Lord. Welcome our live stream viewers today, those of you who are watching that way, and so thankful those of you who are live in person chose to be with us on this Lord's Day. Amen. Amen. Psalm 67 is our text this morning. As you're getting ready for your Christmas decorations, don't forget, you can buy your live tree right out here out front. It will support the Jameson Real Bethlehem Jerusalem School over there, and help us out with that. If you wonder what all the netting is on the parking lot, it's a Christmas tree booth, amen? But if you'll buy them all this morning, we'll take it down, amen? We won't even have to, amen? Chris said he'd be good with that. Just go ahead and sell them all this morning. You can sign them at the back, amen? Amen. Glad to have you in the Lord's house on the Lord's Day. Psalm 67 is our text today. We are in the midst of much thought and prayer about our nation in this season. Amen? Amen. It's great to be an American, great to be a child of God today. Here we are on the other side of both Election Day and Veterans Day. And on this day, we're going to study, as we continue our 6 weeks in the Psalms, we're going to study Psalm 67. I chose this psalm today because it is a national psalm. It is a prayer of blessing on the nation. It was a psalm that Israel sang, asking God to smile upon their country. And I believe it's a very fitting prayer for our country as well today. And I want us to read it together responsibly. We'll read the first verse together, and then I'll pick the second one up, and we'll go back and forth until we share this psalm together. Amen. Psalm 67. And so I'll begin. We'll begin together with verse 1, and then we'll read it responsibly. You read the part in black. I'll read the part in italics there. And you read the boldface, and we'll read together. Let's join our voices in this psalm together. God be merciful to us and bless us, and cause His face to shine upon us, Selah, that Your way may be known on earth, Your salvation among all nations. Oh, let the nations be glad and sing for joy, for You shall judge the people righteously and govern the nations of the earth, Selah.
Let the people praise You, O God, and all the people praise You.
Then the earth shall yield her increase. God, our own God, shall bless us.
God shall bless us, and all the ends of the earth shall fear You.
May God add a blessing to the reading of His word, His people said. Amen. You know, this morning, here we are looking at this great prayer. It's very rich in text. It's short, but it packs a lot in it. And I want you to pick this apart today, and I want you to notice very quickly four things about this passage that I believe apply to us as we seek to pray for our nation. I would expect that many of us have prayed for our country in the last few weeks, probably more so than we have in a long time. Some of us, maybe more than ever, we have in our lifetime. But moments like elections and difficulty often turn our hearts to praying and lifting up our voices to God and seeking His blessing. And I believe this psalm gives us a great way to know how should we pray and what does God look for whenever we pray for our nation. What kind of prayer will He answer for our country? And what are the prerequisites? What do we have to do in order to get God to answer that kind of prayer? Amen. I want you to notice that with me this morning. Number one, notice the prayer's group mindset. This prayer has a group mindset. Say group mindset. In other words, the focus is collective, not individual. I want you to notice that. The very first verse, he says, may God bless us, be merciful to us and bless us, and cause His face to shine upon us. Notice, he does not pray, Lord, be merciful to me and bless me and let Your face shine on me. Notice that. It isn't there. The prayer is corporate. It's collective. It is, Lord, be merciful to us. Bless us. Let Your face shine upon us. Everybody say us.
Us.
You know, if there is something that we ought to clue into at the very beginning of this prayer, it is this simple reality. God likes to hear us pray in the plural. God likes us but say, bless us. Amen? God likes to hear you say us. He loves that on the lips of His people because that is His heart, the heart that is not only for Himself, but for others. And so that's the way it begins. In earthly politics, this is where things often break down. It's easy for one group of people to get focused on what is best for themselves or their family or the people in their own socioeconomic group, the people in their own demographic. And it's easy to focus on what is best for me rather than what is best for all of us as a nation and a country. And prayers like this remind us that whenever we pray for our country, we're praying for our entire country. We're praying for all of us. Amen? That's the focus of the prayer, that we would pray for our entire nation. Even in prayer, sometimes we catch ourselves praying prayers that really focus on our four and no more. How many times have you ever listened to yourself praying and looked over your list and realized how narrow our prayer life can become? Have you noticed that? I have. I didn't notice it for years. When I was in school, I started using a little thing to help me pray. It was called the Book of Common Prayer. And in that little guide to prayer every day, it has some recommended prayers that you pray and you lift up for your nation. And I began to notice that in that little book, it was urging me and prompting me to pray for things that I often didn't pray for. For instance, the prayer at the close of the day, I've always prayed for me and for my family to be blessed and have a safe night and for God to watch over us and keep us through the night. But in that little prayer book, I found a prayer that went something like this. Keep watch over us, O Lord, who work or watch or weep this night, and give thine angels charge over those who sleep. Bless the suffering, soothe the dying, pity the afflicted, and shield the joyous, and all for your love's sake. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. What a great prayer to pray at night. That prayer doesn't just pray for me and my family. That prayer prays for people all around me, no matter what situation they might be in. Can I tell you, that's exactly how Jesus taught us to pray. Do you remember? He didn't teach us to pray, my Father. He taught us to pray what? Our Father, which art in heaven. And He taught us to pray, forgive us, lead us, give us. That's the prayer. The prayer is plural in focus. It's not individual. It's collective. There's a group mindset. Say a group mindset. We have to think about more than our four and no more. More than our tribe or our family. Or even those who are just like us when we pray. God calls us to pray largely, broadly, to push the borders out when we pray. A friend of mine, when I was in seminary, he taught me to pray this way. I loved his pattern. Every day he would push the circle out a little further. On Sunday he prayed for his church. On Monday he prayed for his family. On Tuesday he prayed for his extended family. On Wednesday he prayed for his community. On Thursday he prayed for his nation. On Friday, he prayed for missionaries who were around the world. And on Saturday, he prayed for world leaders who led the governments all over the world. And then on Sunday, back to his church and his family. And every day, he was pushing the circle a little further out of his prayer life. And it taught him to enlarge his heart and pray. The Lord's Prayer does that for us in another way. Before we ever get to pray for what we need, forgive us our trespasses, lead us not into temptation, give us our daily bread. Before we ever get to those three requests, we get to three other requests. We pray for the things on God's heart before we pray for the things on our heart. Before I mention my laundry list of needs, I'm taught to pray, Lord, let your name be considered holy by everyone. Lord, let your kingdom come on the earth. And Lord, let your will be done here, just as it is in heaven. Those things ought to exercise me in prayer just as much as I pray for the things on my list that attend to me and my family. That's the pattern Jesus taught us when we pray. Does your prayer life look like that? Does your prayer life follow the model that the Savior gave us when He taught us to pray? Many of us, if we're honest, our prayer life is pretty tightly focused in on our immediate pain and our suffering, and the suffering of the people who are close enough to us to make it on our list or our radar screen when we pray. But that's not the way Jesus taught us. Jesus said to pray, our Father, give us, forgive us, lead us. There's a lot of us in the Lord's Prayer. Jesus went further and said, if we want our sins forgiven by God, we have to be extending that forgiveness to other people. We can't stand and ask God to forgive us of our sins if we are insisting on holding on and keeping a record of the sins of others who've harmed us. James taught us that whenever we pray for selfish reasons, we pray amiss. Means we miss the mark. We miss the will of God. Our prayer will not be powerful in God's presence. He will ignore such a prayer because it is wide of the mark of His good and perfect will. Why? Because we must pray in Jesus' name. Say, in Jesus' name. To pray in Jesus' name does not just mean we say those words at the end of the prayer. To pray in Jesus' name means we must pray a prayer that Jesus Himself would have signed off on. You see, it's sort of like being handed a check by Jesus. And you get to fill in, pay the order of, and you get to put the amount on there. And Jesus has stamped His name on the bottom of the check. That happens here at the church sometimes, you know. Someone will come and they'll need to make a Sam's run for the church. And we'll give them a church check. And it has my name on the bottom and it has Tony Lewis's name on the bottom, your pastor and your treasurer. And they walk out of here with that check and they hand that check to the clerk at Sam's and she takes a check in our name. Now, I would imagine that if someone walked in with a check from the Forest Hill Church of God and somebody tried to load it down with a carton full of questionable items, like on the wine rack over there, I would hope that somebody at the counter would look at that check and go, "Whoa, wait up just a minute. I don't believe this check was intended for this purchase." And they would likely pick up the phone and say, "Excuse me, Pastor, did you authorize a purchase of Merlot for the Forest Hill Church of God?" I'd say, "Sorry, we're teetotalers. We even take communion with Welch's." Amen? No. Why? You couldn't cash that check in our name. Why? The check wouldn't match our character. You understand? The character has to line up with the request. That's how it is when we pray. To pray in Jesus' name is not only to add His name on the bottom like a signature on a check. Whenever your request, whenever your prayer gets to heaven, whenever your check slides across the desk of glory, it must be a believable prayer. The angels must look. The Father must hear the prayer and say, "You know, that is something my son would have asked me for. I'm going to grant that request." That's what it means to pray in Jesus' name. Give God a prayer He's willing to answer. Give God a prayer that matches the character and the mission of Jesus. We have to be careful about what we attach His name to. Amen? It's sort of like some of the funerals that I've attended. A friend of mine, a great old preacher of the faith, one time he went to a funeral and he said, "Pastor, have you ever heard anybody preach a funeral where they didn't say, 'I believe the person went to heaven'?" I said, "You know, I don't know if I have." And he said, "Well, preacher, I'm just not convinced that God's taking everything we send it up there." Amen. I agree. I don't know that heaven's taking everything we're sending. Well, heaven doesn't cash every check we write, because only a prayer that can be offered in the name of Jesus will make it into God's presence. Only a prayer that Jesus Himself will sign off on. That's what it means to pray in Jesus' name. We pray with His authority, we pray with His backing, but we must pray in line with His character and His will, and that means we can't pray selfish prayers. If we pray that we may consume it on our own lust, the Bible says we ask amiss and God will not hear that prayer. Selfish prayers can't be offered in the name of the selfless Son of God who surrendered His life for others on the cross. It just doesn't make sense. Let me say something to those of us today who stand on the other side of Election Tuesday. And we are very excited about the outcome of the election. And we are even seeing it as an answer to prayer. Let me remind us of some things today as we pray for our country. Let me say this. I want you to remember that we pray just as ardently and fervently in other elections where they didn't always go our way. So be aware of that and continue to pray for your country. No matter which side of this you're on, prayer will do more than anything else will do. Has it come to that? Oh, it's come to that. Prayer will move the hand of God, and that'll do far more than drawing a circle by anyone's name on Tuesday did. Amen? Remember that there are those not just in our community, but within our own congregation who love Jesus, who believe the gospel, and who are seeking to follow Him in their daily lives. And they are just as anxious about the outcome of the election as many of you would have been had the election gone the other direction. And so be sensitive to that as you celebrate the answer to prayer that we believe God's given us on the election. Pray for your brothers and sisters who are fearful that they will be negatively impacted Pray for your friends of a different ethnic group who wonder if their family members may be forced out of the country or not allowed re-entry at some later date. Pray for those who fear that their children may be targeted for discrimination. I wrote and spoke this morning very briefly with Johan and Yodi over at Nueva Vida Church of God, our daughter church, a church of 150 who gathered this morning over on Nursery Road, who are part of our congregation, who are members of the Forest Hill Church of God, technically, and who is actually a staff pastor for us and our congregation. And I spoke with him and encouraged him and let him know we love you and we are praying for you. And we're praying for your congregation this morning that God will help you be a voice of reassurance and peace and comfort to those that you lead today. And that you will do what we are doing. We will turn our eyes toward Jesus and we will pray for God's will to be done and God's blessing to take place on this nation that we share together. So remember that today. Remember, the Bible says in Hebrews 13, verse 3, this is a great verse. Remember the prisoners as if chained with them. Remember those who are mistreated, since you yourselves are also in the body. Remember, since you yourselves are also in the body. You see, you and I are one body in Christ today. One body. When one part hurts, we all hurt. It bothers me, it troubles me to know that I have brothers and sisters who are fearful today. It troubles me to know that my friends are troubled and that many of them wonder not only if they are truly loved and accepted, but if they're merely tolerated in congregations that are predominantly white or predominantly Republican. That is a very fearful thing for many people. And we have to be aware of that as people who sit together as the people of God. We have to understand we have a call to pray for one another. We have a call to pull together as one body and as one church family in moments like this. Now is the time that we pray. Now is the time that we reassure our brothers and sisters of our love and support. To pray the kinds of prayers we would want someone to pray for us had the election gone the other direction on Tuesday. How would we be feeling and how would we be praying? Well, we are called to return the favor and remember our brothers and sisters on days like this. One of my favorite quotes in this whole cycle has come from a man named Samuel Rodriguez. Samuel Rodriguez is a Hispanic pastor, pastors in Los Angeles, California. Brother Rodriguez preached at both the International General Assembly for the Church of God, and he preached at the Alabama State Camp Meeting last June. And this was the quote, I loved it. He said, a divided church will never heal a broken nation. A divided church will never heal a broken nation. We're called like never before to be an agent of healing in our country. And that only begins if we are healed, if we are one, if we are united in Christ as brothers and sisters. Then we can become that healing agent for the community that is around us. I'll speak to the other side of the issue in just a moment, so don't go to lunch early. Amen? But for now, back to our text. Notice our text today. What are we to pray for? This collective, group-minded prayer. What are we to pray for ourselves and others? Well, number one, notice what he says. The prayer is, we are to pray for his divine pardon. Say pardon.
Pardon.
We're to pray for pardon. He says, Lord, be merciful to us. The first prayer is a prayer for mercy. And that is where we must begin when we pray. We begin here every time we pray. Why? Because we're keenly aware of our own sins and shortcomings. Because we understand that even if we don't feel we personally have done anything, we represent a group of people, the Church of the Lord Jesus, who is a mixed bag. You and I have had successes and failures this week. We've had moments where we greatly pleased and probably disappointed the Lord. Amen? We are a mixed bag. And so whenever the church gathers to pray, we pray, Lord, be merciful to us. Amen? We pray that prayer. We pray the prayer of Psalm 103. Lord, thank you that you've not dealt with us according to our sins, nor punished us according to our transgressions. But as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great has your mercy been on those of us who fear you. Aren't you thankful for that? That the Father hasn't dealt with us according to our sins, but according to his mercy. He's not remembered our faults. He's looked on our faith today. Aren't you glad? Because of our faith in the Lord Jesus, our sins have been forgiven and our hearts have been made right with God. And we can rejoice in that today. We pray for pardon. We acknowledge our sins. And if we regard iniquity in our heart, the Lord will not hear us. If we take our sin lightly, it will stop his ears to our prayer. But if we come confessing and repenting, he will hear us and be gracious to us. Psalm 130 said, Lord, if you marked our transgressions, who would be able to stand in your presence? Isn't that the truth? I mean, if God was a little nitpicky bean counter who put a tally mark by your name every time you did anything that slightly deviated from His perfect will, I don't know about you, I filled up a 5-subject notebook this week. Amen? Amen? Lord, if you marked our transgressions, who would stand before you? But with you there is mercy, therefore you are to be feared. Aren't you thankful today for the mercy of God? So the first thing we pray, Lord, be merciful to us. Not only to me, but to all of us. And the second prayer we pray is not only for pardon, but we pray for provision. Say provision.
Provision.
Lord, be merciful to us and bless us. I love that word, bless. Say bless.
Bless.
The word bless is literally to speak a good word over. We bless the Lord when we praise Him. When we declare good things about God, we are blessing the name of the Lord. Whenever God blesses His people, He speaks a good word over us. Well, what good does that do? Well, I'll remind you, God created everything in the heaven and earth by speaking it out of His mouth. God said, let there be light, and there was light. God spoke the world into existence. And if God speaks a good word over your life, that good word will come to pass. All God has to do to prosper you and provide for you is to bless you. All He has to do is speak the word, and your prosperity will come. Amen? So the psalmist prayed, Lord, bless us. Speak a good word over us. We need God to speak words of promise and purpose over our lives. Amen? Whenever a man in the Old Testament would lay his hands on his sons, he would bless them. He would call out the good things he saw in them. He would remind them of who they were. And then prophetically, he would speak their destiny over them. He would declare how God was going to prosper them and how God was going to use them and how the good things in their character were going to lead them into prosperity and into a good future. And when God looks at us, He has mercy on us, but not only does He forgive us, He doesn't just tolerate us, He blesses us. He speaks a good word over us. He declares promise and purpose over our lives so that we might truly be blessed. Notice that the blessing of God is always conditional. What do you mean? Well, there's an if and a then. There's my part and there's God's part. It's a conditional promise. Look with me, Leviticus 26, verses 3 to 5. If you walk in my statutes, say if. If you walk in my statutes and keep my commandments and perform them, then, say then. Then I will give you the rain in its season, the land will yield its produce, and the trees of the field will yield their fruit. That's the blessing of God, amen? If I will obey Him, He will speak positive words of blessing and pardon and provision over my life. But I have to obey God. The psalmist says it very plainly, if I'm willing and obedient, I'll eat the good of the land. That was God's promise to His people. So we pray for pardon and provision. And finally, we pray for His presence. Say His presence.
Presence.
Lord, be merciful to us. Lord, bless us. And Lord, cause Your face to shine on us. Don't you love that? Cause Your face to shine on us. Now by this point in the verse, you know immediately what this psalmist is thinking about. He is thinking back to the prayer that Aaron spoke over the people of God when he dismissed them from worshiping at the tabernacle. This is the high priestly blessing. This is the blessing of Aaron. These are the same words that we proclaim over our congregation either Sunday morning or Sunday night, one or the other. We do it every week that rolls. We proclaim this blessing, the blessing of Aaron that says, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord lift His countenance upon you. May the Lord cause His face to shine on you and be gracious to you. And may the Lord grant you His peace. Numbers 6, 24 through 26. In the Old Testament, God's face was a symbol of God's presence. So when it says, let Your face shine on us, what He's saying is, let Your presence be with us. Lord, we want, not only do we want Your blessing, we don't just want Your provision, we want You to be with us. Let Your face shine on us. If you've got my face, then you've got me. Amen? It's the idea of having someone's attention. You know, often we live in a day where we're so distracted, people are talking to us, and we're looking at our phone, or we're looking around the room, and we're saying, yeah, uh-huh, yeah, okay. No. But sometimes our little kids teach us better, don't they? I've had Abigail reach up before and grab me by the chin and turn my head back to her, put her hands right here and go, I want to say it to your face. I want your face. yesterday, her mom had her in her arms, and she was busy doing something, had her, and she said, "Mom, I really like that. You see that? Yeah, uh-huh. And she said, "Mom, are you playing with me? You're not even looking at that. You must be playing with me." By age 4, she knows the difference between when you have the face or not. I want to tell you something. It's not enough to have God's provision. I want God's blessing. I want God to bless my life. But can I tell you something? Israel learned an important lesson. The promised land is no blessing if God is not there with them. Because there came a time when God left, His glory lifted. And you know what? The land was parched and dry and barren, and there was a famine, and there was a drought, and their enemies came in and took them. The land is not a blessing without the presence of God. You hear me? We don't want just God's blessing. We want God's face. We don't just want provision. We want His presence. For God's face to shine on us is a symbol of His approval. For your face to shine is a symbol, it's a Hebrew way of saying, smile on us. Don't just look on us, but look on us and smile. It's a prayer not only that God would bless us, but that we would be the kind of people that make God's heart glad. We would be the kind of people that God delights in. It's a prayer for God's approval. Lord, smile on us. Don't just be merciful to us. Don't just bless us materially. Lord, give us hearts that delight in Your will. Let us walk in Your ways so that You're truly pleased with us. Make us people who cause Your heart to smile, who reflect Your character, who make Your heart glad. We want to make You beam with joy. We want to be Your holy children in whom You delight. That is the prayer of the people of God. Lord, be merciful to us. Bless us. And make us the kind of people that cause You to smile when You think of us. Wow, what a great prayer. The prayer has a group mindset. Say group mindset. Number 2, it's got a global mission. Say global mission. Move on to the next verse. Look at verse 2. Why are we going to pray this prayer? What is the point? How do we know God will answer the prayer? Why would God be interested in blessing this little nation of Israel? They're really a nobody if you look at the world stage that they lived in. They were not a superpower. They did not have great wealth. They didn't have a great military. They didn't cover a large amount of land. None of those things are true of them. Why are they so bold as to believe that God is going to bless them and give them His presence above all the other nations on the earth? Why are they so confident God's going to hear this prayer? Here's why. They tied their prayer to the purpose of God. I've told you this several times lately. If you want your prayer answered, tie what you're praying for to something that God desires. Tie what you want to what God wants, and that prayer will get answered. Hannah wanted a son. God wanted a prophet who would turn Israel back to God. And so God looked down at Hannah when she said, "If you'll give me a son, I'll give him back to you all the days of his life." And God said, "You just made a deal." Wow. Remember the story of Jesus and the wedding of Cana in John the 2nd chapter? Mary comes and says, "Jesus, the guests have run out of wine. They've run out of refreshments." And Jesus says, "What is that to me?" In other words, that's very sad. They really should have counted better. They should have had Gloria doing the refreshments, right? She would have counted that guest list better. They would have run out of wine. But no, what happened? Jesus looks at her and says, "Woman, what does your request have to do with me?" What was he saying? What he was saying is this: I don't just do miracles because I'm God. I don't just do miracles because you have a need. I don't just do miracles because there is something uncomfortable going on in your life. Jesus said, "What does your request have to do with me?" And then Jesus told the disciples to fill the water pitchers with water, and He blessed them, and they turned into wine. And the Bible says at the end of that passage that then the disciples put their faith in Him because here they saw His glory. Do you hear me? The point of the miracle was not that the guests have their wine glasses filled. The point of the miracle was the disciples saw the glory of God in Jesus, and they trusted in Him and believed He was the Messiah. We have to tie our need to something God wants. We have to tie our request to God's request, our want to God's want. And when we do that, the prayer has a lot better likelihood of getting answered. How do you know that? Look at verse 2. Why do we expect God to be merciful and bless and cause His face to shine us? Look at verse 2. that your way may be known on earth, your salvation among all the nations. That's why. If God blesses us, it is not so that we might be selfish with the blessing. If God blesses us, it's not because He likes us better than other nations or other churches or other families. If God blesses us, it is because He intends that blessing to become a blessing for people outside of ourselves. Amen. This is the promise. This is what God said in the book of Genesis when the Lord told He told Abraham these words, Genesis 12, verse 1. Get out of your country, from your family and your father's house, to the land that I will show you. I will make you a great nation. I will bless you and make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and I will curse him who curses you. Why? So that in you all the families of the earth may be blessed. Why am I blessing Abraham? To bless Israel. Why am I blessing Israel? So that Israel can be my missionary to the rest of the world. I'm going to take this little group of people and I'm going to lift them out of bondage and I'm going to make them stand in spite of their weakness. I'm going to reveal myself to them and I'm going to bless them, and then they are going to be my light to cause the other nations to know the truth about God. God says when He blesses us, it's never primarily for our benefit. When God blesses me, He doesn't just have me in mind. Dr. E.B. Hill used to say it this way: God will get it to you if God can get it through you. Amen. The reason some people aren't blessed is they're stingy with the blessing. And the reason some people have a lot and abound is because they're generous with the blessing that God gives them. Proverbs says there is that which takes hold on the more than should be held, and it turns to nothing. And there is him that sows generously, and it comes back to him in abundance. You see, if we will be a blessing, God will indeed bless us. If He can trust us in that way. In order for Israel to fulfill their global mission of revealing God to the rest of the world, they are to make known two things about God. Number one, let your way be known on the earth. Say, your way. God's way is revealed in the law. The Old Testament, the law, the book of Deuteronomy, God gave them His way of life. He showed them the way in which they were to live. The way is the law. Say, the law. God told us about His law. Psalm 1, we preached it last Sunday. The Torah, God's instruction manual on how to live a blessed life. It's not a burden, it's a gift. It is light in a dark place. And if our blessing is tied to our obedience, the first step is knowing what God expects of us. Amen? The law explains God's expectations of His people. And so we have God's law. And that's a great first step. But that's not the only thing we ought to make known. The second thing is this: your way on the earth, your salvation among all the nations. Say, salvation.
Salvation.
We're not only called to declare God's way, we're called to declare His salvation, His saving help. What is that? Well, we learn God's way in the law, but we learn about God's salvation in the gospel. Say, the gospel. And so we proclaim both law and gospel as the people of God. We preach the Old Testament and the New Testament. The first principle of the Church of God is the whole Bible rightly divided. The law and the gospel, Old and New Testament, preached with understanding. We're to declare God's Word. You see, the law shows us God's holiness. And the law can show us our own sinfulness. But the law can never enable us to please God. The law can show me what I'm doing wrong, but it can never give me the ability to do right. You see, there is a spiritual birth defect. I was born with it, and you were born with it. You were born with a heart that desires to do wrong. You were born with an inner desire to ignore God, to not want God in your life, to break God's commandments, and to make excuses so you can live any way you want to live. And if you die living that way, you will die separated from God. And you'll wake up in a place called hell one day. That's what the Bible teaches. Well, Pastor, how can I ever get out of that conundrum? How do I get out of this quandary that I'm in? Well, the law won't give it to you, but the gospel will. The good news is this: God sent His Son, the Lord Jesus, and Jesus took all of your sin. Every time you broke God's law, Jesus bore that on His cross. He took your death penalty. He paid the price for your sin. He died on the cross so that you would not have to die and go to hell. Jesus rose from the dead, and that proved that God had accepted His sacrifice for your sin. And today, if you will come before Jesus, and you will bow down and say, I'm sorry for my sin. I don't want to live that way anymore. I believe You died for me. I believe You rose from the dead. Forgive me. Cleanse me. Come be my Master and my Savior. If you'll do that, God will forgive you. God will bring you into His family, and you can know His forgiveness today. If I use God's law to point out my sins and show me my need for a Savior, then it's a blessing. If I let God's law show me how He wants to transform my character to make me more like Jesus, if I allow the Holy Spirit to use the law to show me what He's trying to turn me into, a man who walks in His ways, then the law's a blessing. Say a blessing. But if I try to use the law as a ladder to climb my way up to God, it will only condemn me. Why? Because nobody can keep the whole law. None of us obey the law perfectly. None of us is without sin in this room. None of us. We've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Isaiah said there's none righteous, not even one. There's not one who seeks after God on his own. So what do we have to do? We have to admit our sin and trust Jesus alone to be our Savior. That's what we must do. So don't miss the bigger picture here. God's blessing of His people is supposed to lead to them being a light to the nations, spreading the Word of God as missionaries to the rest of the world. He blesses us so that His way may be known on the earth, His salvation to the ends of the world. That's what Paul says. Why do we pray for kings and rulers and those in authority? Well, in 1 Timothy 2, verses 1 to 4, he says, we do it in order that we may lead a quiet, peaceable life with all godliness and reverence. For this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who desires all men to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. The reason Paul is praying for the government is so the church can live at peace. Why does he want the church to live at peace? So the church can spread the gospel to the nations. It's not just so they can have an easy life. It's so they can do the will of God and be God's missionaries to the world around us. A moment ago, I spoke to those of us who were in support of Mr. Trump's candidacy. Now let me say something to those of us who struggled with the decision of 81% of evangelical Christians who supported Mr. Trump for president. Please do not interpret the vote of everyone who voted for him as an agreement with everything that he has done or said in the past. Remember everything you know to be good and true about your brothers and sisters. Don't judge the motive behind their vote unless you've spoken to them about the reasons that they voted the way they did. Unless you've taken the time to hear their heart. Most of them saw their decision not as a vote for one man, but as a vote against another candidate that they feared even more greatly. Many others believe that the platform of one party reflected biblical values better than the platform of the other party, especially when it came to issues such as the sanctity of life or the biblical definition of marriage. And because they voted for that, they voted for the party's platform, even though they disliked the candidate who represented it, perhaps as much as you did. But for the sake of Christ, let none of us cross the line of de-Christianizing one another, or judging another believer's hidden motives, or assume we're more insightful enough to understand all that motivated their vote. Whether you voted for a donkey, an elephant, or some third animal that wasn't on the list. Let's not judge one another's motive of why we voted how we voted, especially until we've taken the time to sit down across a cup of coffee for a few hours from one another and hear one another's story and understand why we feel so strongly as we do about issues like this. It might come to surprise us why some people feel so strongly. It might be quite a surprise to many people who were adamantly opposed to Donald Trump to find out that many people who voted for him didn't like him a lot either. But they feared the other party more. And so they did, because they felt it was the only way to stop an even worse agenda.
Amen.
Many Christians who voted for Donald Trump might be surprised to understand that those who did not vote for him shared your pro-life convictions. They believe the same thing that you do about family, and those issues are very important to them as well, but there were other issues that made them equally afraid to pull a lever in his direction. So they took a different approach. Many of them even voted for a third party candidate. The bottom line is this. How do you get to unity beyond this? Well, you have a conversation with other people. You have a meeting of the minds. You invite them over to your home. You sit down and have a cup of coffee. You talk with them about your common faith, and you seek to understand why you came to different conclusions about an issue like this. But let's not assume what we don't know about each other's motives, especially when we haven't had a conversation with one another. Amen? And for the sake of both our Christian witness and our church's unity, please cease and desist. Let's take a hiatus from Facebook fighting. Yes. Amen. You don't have to agree with anybody, but remember that whenever you go on Facebook, children, you are in public. Facebook is a public place, okay? It's public. And that means what we say and do in that forum becomes a reflection of our church and our individual Christian testimony. So be careful in that forum. Be careful. Doesn't mean we can't talk and dialogue. It does mean we have to walk in an extra measure of grace, because we can easily be misunderstood and understand others are listening to our conversation in those forums. It's not a private phone call unless it was an inbox message. Amen? And then be careful, because someone can copy and paste your inbox message and make it public very quickly. Walk in wisdom. Amen? And let your speech be always with grace, seasoned with salt. That's the word of the Lord for us. All right, back to our text and soon to lunch. Our prayers for God's blessing must be based on a group mindset. Say a group mindset. I must care about the whole church and those beyond the church. Number two, it must be focused on a global mission. Say a global mission. I have to understand that God blesses our nation so that it can send the gospel to the world. And God will not bless our nation if our nation turns away from Him or His purposes. He has no obligation to bless us unless we walk in His ways. Amen. Number three, finally, notice the prayer's glorious motive. Say the motive. Look at verses 3-5. We read it together today. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. Notice that. I love that. Let all the peoples praise you, Lord. He says in verse 4, Oh, let the nations be glad and sing for joy, for you will judge the people righteously and govern the nations on the earth. Let the people praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. Notice that. This prayer has a glorious motive. The camera angle widens out again. It's not just bless me, it's bless us. And it's God bless us in order that we might be a blessing to the nations. But notice, their salvation is for an even greater purpose. Why is God going to bless me? So I can be a missionary. Why am I going to be a missionary? So others can be saved. But don't stop pushing the envelope yet. Why do we want those other people to be saved? Well, because we don't want them to go to hell. Well, that's noble and that's true, but it's only half true. For the Christian, there is another motive. There's another reason we preach the gospel. And there's another reason we live a Christian life. It is not only because we want to go to heaven. It's not only because we want other people to go to heaven. Don't miss it. Lord, be merciful to us and bless us. Why? So that we can make your way and your salvation known in the earth. Why? So that those people, when they are saved, will turn and give glory to your name. What is the purpose of missions? What is the purpose of preaching the gospel? What is the purpose of planting churches and taking mission trips? Let me tell you, it's very simple. Because the Son of God left heaven and came to earth. And that holy, righteous Son of God hung between heaven and earth on a bloody cross and emptied Himself of His power and His dignity and His glory and emptied Himself of all but love and bled for Adam's helpless race. And He hung there and He died and He submitted Himself to death, even the death of the cross. And because He was so humiliated and died for sinners, the Bible says God has determined that He would raise His Son up from the dead. Not only would He raise Him from death, He would raise Him off the earth and seat Him in heaven. Not only would He seat Him in heaven, He would seat Him far above all principality and power and authority, that one day every knee would bow about an island that was filled with slaves. It was a plantation island, and the slave owner was the only one who could allow anyone to come on or leave the island. He was a harsh man, and he was not a Christian, and he did not want anyone preaching the gospel to the slaves on his island. He would not allow anyone to come plant a church or even hold a chapel service. It was reported that a couple times a pastor or a missionary or a preacher had ended up having to land on that island because of a storm, and he would keep them in a separate facility until they could leave. And he would not allow them to have any contact with the slaves on his island. Why? He did not want them to hear the gospel of Jesus. He was a very hard man, a very angry man against God. And he did not want them to have any interaction with the gospel. There was only one way to get on the island. You had to come on a slave boat. You had to come as a slave of that plantation owner. There was a couple of Arabian missionaries who desired more than anything in all the world. They desired for those men and women to hear the gospel of Jesus and to be saved. So they did the unthinkable thing. They sold themselves into slavery to the plantation owner. And they took the money they received from their sale and bought their boat ticket to sail out to the island of the plantation owner. The last anyone ever heard or saw of these two young men, they were standing on the bow of a boat. And as it sailed out of the harbor, out the coast of England, a young man in his 20s stepped up and waved back to his friends and said, "May the Lamb who was slain receive the reward of his suffering. May the Lamb who was slain receive the reward of his suffering." Why did they go? They went because there was a Savior in heaven who bled and died for those people on the island. And he deserved that one day a group of those people would join the throne and bow their knee and cast their crown down at his feet and shout, "The Lord reigns." Amen. What is the motive of all this? Notice the glorious motive of the prayer. "Lord, be merciful to us. Forgive us. Bless us. Make your face shine on us." Why? So we can be your missionaries to the earth. Why? So that those people will join us around the throne, and the song will get bigger, and the crowd will grow larger, and the name of Jesus will be shouted even farther to the corners of the globe around us. That's the motive of the prayer. You see it? "Lord, bless us, keep us." Why? So that we can make your way known. Why? So that all the peoples will praise you, God. So that they will glory in your name. So that you will govern them and judge them righteously. In his book, "Let the Nations Be Glad," John Piper said, "Missions exist because worship does not. Missions exist so that worship will get bigger." We send missionaries to gather more men and women around the throne of God to shout the name of Jesus. The Lamb who was slain is worthy that men from every tribe, tongue, nation, and people would appear before the throne, bow at his pierced feet, and cry with all of heaven, "Worthy is the Lamb." Amen and amen. God saved us and blessed us so we could share his gospel. So in order to prepare the world for that great final day when he will judge the people and govern the nations. Now what happens when we pray like this? Well, two things. There's a great manifestation. Number one, there's earthly blessing. Verse 6, "Then the earth will yield its fruit." Do you want God to bless you materially? Do you want God to bless you financially? Make your life about the kingdom of God. Make your giving about the kingdom of God. Make the goal of your life the kingdom of God, and God will bless. God will bless. Matthew 6:33, "Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you as well." If we'll seek the kingdom, if we'll take care of God's kingdom, God will take care of our kingdom. Amen. This is what he said. This is what Paul told the church. He told the church, "Because you have been faithful to sow into the ministry of Paul the missionary, and because I have everything I need and abound," he told the Philippian Christians, Philippians 4:19, "because you gave to the work of the ministry, because you supplied my need, now my God shall supply all of your need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus." One more verse, Malachi 3:10. When you trust God enough to put him first and bring the tithe into the storehouse, then he will pour out blessing that there will not be room enough to receive. Why? Because our tithe is somehow magical? No, not at all. But because when God sees our heart that we put him first, He blesses a heart like that. He blesses a life like that. He blesses a church like that. He blesses a nation like that. Amen? Amen. Being able, but notice this, there's an even greater blessing, not only earthly blessing, heavenly blessing. He says, God, our own God, shall bless us. God, our own God. Say that with me. God, our own God. There is no greater blessing than being able to call God my God. To being able to call the Lord our God. He's not just God. He's our God. We're His family. We're His sons and daughters. We're His children. He has set His love on us. He's made us His people. He's called us by His name. Amen. The blessings of the gospel far exceed any material or financial benefit we could ever have. Amen. The kingdom of God is not food and drink, Paul said. It's righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Ghost. And only Jesus can give you those things. Only God can give you a heart that's right. Only God can give you a heart at peace. Only God can fill you up with joy. Amen? Righteousness, peace, and joy. The psalmist said, blessed is the man whose transgression is forgiven. Blessed is the one whose sin is covered. Blessed is the one to whom the Lord has not imputed iniquity. The hymn writer said it this way, pardon for sin and a peace that endureth. Thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide. Strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Stand with me all over the Lord's house. Solomon said, let us hear the conclusion of the matter. What unites us as a church is not that we agree on every issue or we'll vote the same in every election. Unity does not mean uniformity. We don't have to be twins to be brothers and sisters. We must be united in our common love for one another. When we are, it will be demonstrated by the fact that we pray not only for ourselves, but we pray for the larger body of Christ and the larger nation. We must be united in our common faith that Jesus is the only Savior from sin, the only risen Lord who conquered death and hell, the only soon coming reigning King whose kingdom will have no end, the only hope for our nation or any nation. We don't worship the donkey or the elephant, we worship the Lamb of glory today. And that's what unites us today. It's Jesus. What we have in common in Jesus is bigger than what we have different in every other area of life. What we share in Christ has to elevate us above all the differences that we have. We may never all be the same ethnicity in this church. I pray to God that we're not. I want our church to reflect the diversity of our community and the diversity of the throne of God gathered around heaven. That's what a biblical church would look like. We won't all reflect one another socioeconomically. Amen. There will always be people in our church that are financially blessed more than others. That's the way things go in this life. We won't always agree on every policy or everything that comes across the pipe. We won't always agree on the same football team. Proud of my Rebels. Yes, I am. Well, let me tell you, the thing that we agree on ought to be big enough to elevate us above the rest. Because what we agree on is we agree on the Lord Jesus. We agree that we were sinners in need of a Savior. And God set His love on us. And God provided for our forgiveness. God brought us into His family and adopted us. And He seated us around His table. As long as we're willing to sit with everybody else around that same table. Amen. God brought us into His family. And God made us brothers and sisters with each other. And like brothers and sisters who sometimes spat and disagreed, God says, get along. I tell you what, if some of us don't straighten up, God's going to do that thing I've seen on TV lately where He put two kids in one t-shirt. You see that? Don't make God do that to you. Amen. Lord help us. We've got to learn the lesson as Americans. Simply this. Only when God is King will life be what we all want it to be. Only when Christ returns and rules the nations will there be an end to war and strife, poverty and hunger, sickness and death. But we can enter the kingdom of Christ now by trusting Jesus as Lord and Savior. And we can show the world about what the kingdom of God really is by the way we treat each other and the way we love one another. By this will all men know that you are my disciples. Not by the bumper sticker or the way you voted, but by the fact that you love one another. That's the way we will know. And that's the way we will show. We can begin showing the world what the kingdom of Christ is all about by the way we treat one another. Why? So they'll want to join the kingdom of God too. And they will find Jesus to be a great, worthy Savior. And they'll surrender their hearts to Him. Every head bowed, every eye closed for a moment. Maybe you're here this morning and you say, Pastor, I'm not a Christian. I'm not a believer in Jesus. I don't follow the Lord. Maybe you come here today and maybe the Holy Spirit has spoken to your heart. I want to ask you this. Are you willing to admit and acknowledge that you are a sinner? Are you willing to admit that you have broken God's commandment and lived your life apart from God? Are you willing to be honest about your life? What is your plan when you stand before God to deal with your sin? You know that sin will never be able to enter into heaven. What are you going to do about your sins? What is your plan when you die and stand before Him, the judge of all the earth, who must do what is right? What are you going to do in that day? I want to tell you, there's only one thing that will stand on that day. You can't plead innocent because you're not. And you can't plead guilty because God says the guilty will by no means go unpunished. You only have one plea that will get you an acquittal on the judgment day. And that is to plead the blood and the death and the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. I plead Jesus. I believe that He died and rose for me. And I trusted in His death and resurrection to forgive my sin and make me a new man or woman. Are you here today? Have you trusted Jesus? Have you invited Him to come into your heart and life? Have you asked Him to be your Lord and Savior? Have you surrendered your heart and life to Him? If you haven't, let me tell you this morning, I want to tell you something. Whoever does or does not go into office is the least of your worries. It is the smallest part of your fears and concerns. Because the greater picture is this. There's a King who sits on the throne of the universe. He wasn't up for re-election on Tuesday. And one day He's going to come again and rule the nation. And every one of us are going to stand before Him. And we will either be accepted or rejected in that hour. And we will either live in heaven or we will be banished to a devil's hell forever. And the only difference between heaven and hell is what did you do with Jesus? I feel a burden from the Holy Ghost this morning. If you're here today and you've not trusted Jesus as Lord and Savior, do not wait, do not tarry, do not linger, do not put it off. Get your heart right with God. Repent of your sin. Ask God to forgive you. Ask Him to save you. Tell God you believe Jesus died and rose for you and you want to follow Him with whatever time you have left. Ask God to save you. Cry out, Lord, be merciful to me, a sinner. Bless me. Cause your face to shine. Ask Him to do that. Father, in the name of Jesus, as we prepare to depart the Lord's house, I pray today if there's one under the sound of my voice whose heart's not right with God, one who is not a Christian, one who is not saved, one who doesn't have the peace that passes understanding, one who's not been converted and trusted in Christ, I pray that today would be the day that you touch their heart, and I pray that today would be the day that you draw them to Jesus. Today be the day they come and trust you for Savior and Lord. Grant it today, Lord. Grant it today in Jesus' name. Move among us. Move among us, we pray. Move among us in this hour. We'll give you praise in Jesus' name. Chad, lead us in just one chorus. If you're here this morning and you need to pray, the altar's open. If not, we're going to dismiss. But if you're not saved and right with God, come find a place to kneel. Someone will meet you here. Let's introduce you to the Lord Jesus, who can save you from your sin. Let's sing.
You are worthy to
someplace today, get alone with God. Tell God, I know I'm a sinner and I need your forgiveness. Cry out to Jesus to save you. Tell God that you believe Jesus died and rose again, and that you want to be forgiven and you want to be his child. The Bible says that if you'll believe in your heart on the Lord Jesus, if you'll confess with your mouth that God raised you from the dead, you'll be saved. That's the word of God. Trust him. Confess it. Then what do? Well, you do what Miles did this morning. A few weeks ago, we had communion on the first Sunday of last month. We took bread, we took a cup, and we lifted it, and we prayed for God to forgive our sins and make us right with God. And at the close of that service, Miles came to me with tears in his eyes, and he said, Pastor, when we prayed that prayer and we took communion this morning, I felt something happen on the inside of me. And I know that Jesus has forgiven me of my sins, and I am a Christian. What do I do now? Gave him a copy of Pastor Quinley's book, Your First Steps. Make sure he had a Bible that he could read and understand. And I told him, the way you publicly declare your faith in Jesus is you're baptized in water. And so this morning, this young man who was converted at the Lord's table, baptized as a profession of faith, has shown you the way. How can you be saved today? Trust in the broken body and the shed blood of Jesus. Ask God to forgive you. And then when you know that he has, go public and announce to the world, I have decided to follow Jesus. Announce that to the church. Join Jesus in baptism. Make your faith public. Amen. And then become part of your local congregation. Grow in your faith in Jesus. If you want to know more about that, we'd love to talk to you. If you're a Christian today, you don't have a home church, please come back and visit us. We'd love to have you. Come and join us for life groups. Amen. Church, we'll meet back tonight at 6 o'clock. Evening service tonight. We'll gather together, open God's Word again with song. We'll spend some time in prayer together. We're going to pray for our country tonight. We're going to pray for unity. We're going to pray for healing. We're going to pray God's blessing on our future as a nation. We're going to pray. Amen. Join us tonight as we gather and take some time to do just that. Amen. Amen. All hearts clear, as the Quakers say. Amen. Receive this blessing from the Lord. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord cause his face to shine upon you. May the Lord lift his countenance upon you and be gracious to you. And may the Lord grant you his peace in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost. Amen. Amen. See you tonight. You are dismissed. Remember the shout of the Lord. Bless you.